Okay, so in terms of what DNA is, I'll say this as well at the start. Bio is a really almost definition-based subject with a lot of your short answer questions in particular, some multiple choice as well. You need to know your definitions. I remember my teacher really saying this and emphasizing this a lot when I was in both 1, 2, and 3, 4. Keeping a glossary is really important. It's not too late to start one now. I know you may have just had your exams. You may have another exam, at the end for unit two. Some schools do it differently. They might do, you might have a year one, sorry, unit one and two exam at the end of the year, or you may have your mid-year exam and your end of year exam. But going into unit two, I would really suggest, if you're not already, to keep a good glossary, and just constantly kind of chip away at it after every class, just add some terms to it, because I think that's the best way to do it. And that kind of lets it sit in your head, as opposed to like a week before an exam trying to really smash out a glossary. It might not be as beneficial to you. So I really highly suggest. And then again, keeping that sort of skill, or I guess that strategy, when you're going into 3, 4 is also really important, because again, there's just more terminology. The questions are still definition based. So that's kind of a tip that I would suggest. So in terms of what DNA is, I'm sure you guys will be familiar. You may have looked at it in junior science. So DNA is essentially our source of genetic information, basically our instructions telling the cell what protein to make, what to do ultimately. And then obviously this is passed down from individual to offspring and so on. Okay, so in terms of our genes, so DNA is our, the NA stands for nucleic acid. So that's our kind of really long, big molecule, sort of what we're seeing here. A gene is a really small section of that DNA that codes for a specific protein. So we can see that it may, determine characteristics. It may be for something that is within the cell, maybe for something that is external to the cell. Again, I think I did say it codes for a protein, but you have different genes that do different things. So it may be a protein, it may be, a hormone, it may be an enzyme, or it may be for regulation. Genes sometimes may not even code for anything really that meaningful. So some, sections of genes, some sections of DNA may not be for anything either. So it's really almost case by case when you look at different genes. But it's important to understand that you've got your huge, big, chromosome, your huge nucleic acid, and then a gene is just a little small section of that. Okay, so then zooming in even more, so looking at our genes, looking at our specific nucleotides. So your nucleic acid is what we would call a polymer. So it's a really big molecule, and poly meaning many. It's made up of many small structures, and these small structures are called monomers. So mono meaning one. So your nucleic acid, your DNA, is your polymer. Your nucleotide is your monomer. So it's just that one little unit. You can think of like, bricks making up a house, or like Lego blocks or something like that. But it's important to kind of understand that idea. It's something that kind of recurs in bio. So we have our nucleotide. They are seen here. This picture, obviously, it's a bit of a combination. But we have our nitrogenous bases running here down the middle. We can also see them depicted here. And then this little double helix is what you can kind of call your DNA backbone. And so it's termed a sugar and phosphate backbone. So here we have our phosphate group, and then a sugar, and then a phosphate, and then a sugar, phosphate, sugar. And you can see that that just runs down there. I like to think of it as like a ladder. So if you think of like your sugar and phosphate making the sides of the ladder, and then the nitrogenous bases make those horizontal rungs. That's how I kind of like to think of it in my head. And so one nucleotide is just one of these little things. So just one phosphate group attached to one sugar attached to one nitrogenous base. So those three components, that's what makes up your nucleotide. And then obviously you put a bunch of them together. That's when you've got, if you can think about like one strand of DNA, and then you obviously pair it with another strand, and that's when you get your full molecule. So in terms of our nitrogenous pairing, we've got this idea of complementary base pairing. So complementary is also something that comes up in bio a lot. It's this idea that adenine and thymine and cytosine and guanine, they always go together. So they are complementary, they match each other, and that's how they'll always pair. So it happens spontaneously. You know, you don't need to force them together. It's this idea that adenine and thymine will always pair up together. So this is a really, really important thing to remember, because you'll often get questions about it. You might be given like a single DNA strand and then asked, you know, what would be the corresponding one, just matching your A's and your T's and your C's and your G's. But that's a really, really important thing to understand. So again, a double-stranded helix. So we've got our two strands that run anti-parallel. And then we've got the helix part, which is just this idea of it being kind of like a corkscrew coiled around. So hopefully that makes sense. Okay, and then again, back to kind of zooming out to our genes. So this is our little double helix here. So a nice long string of these nucleotides is what makes up a gene. And again, so if we're thinking about a protein, for example, that's kind of the most common example that we use. So you have a gene and it will be transcribed. So this process of transcription, and then it turns into this molecule mRNA and it'll become a protein. This kind of detailed process is what you look at next year in Bio 3-4. You don't have a look at transcription this year, but it's important to kind of bear that in mind, that that's something that you look at. But also to understand for this year that you have your gene, you know, goes through transcription, goes through translation, gets to this protein, and then that protein is expressed and it does what it needs to do in the cell. So that's the important connection that you have to make in terms of genes, and then that gene being expressed and it resulting in, you know, if it's a protein or if it's anything else, and then that having its role in the cell. So hopefully that makes sense. We can see here, so the length of the gene, the specific base sequence determines what comes out. So your length of the gene obviously determines what gets expressed, and the order of those nucleotides is also really important, because, you know, we've talked about seeing our little rungs here. So this order of nucleotides is what will determine basically what protein gets made. So it's very, very specific. So, you know, we'll talk about mutations a little bit later, but if you had a mutation in one of these and your adenine got switched to a cytosine or got switched to a guanine or something like that, depending on where that mutation is, that may have, you know, a big impact on what's actually produced. It may create a faulty protein, for example. Okay, so looking at alleles. So alleles are ultimately, we've got our little genes, and so our genes, you know, code for certain proteins, code for whatever. Ultimately, that results in a certain characteristic. So you've got a gene for a certain protein, and then, you know, thinking about consequences of that, maybe that gives you a certain hair color, a certain eye color, a certain height, for example. So alleles are basically variety between these specific characteristics. So you have got, you know, this little gene that, let's say, codes for hair color. So an allele will be, you know, codes for brown hair, codes for black hair, codes for blonde hair, for example. So they're all the same gene. It's the exact same gene for hair color. It's found in the same place. It's just that individuals have different variations of this same gene. So hopefully that makes sense. And you can see that it's found on the same place. So if you saw, you know, if I have black hair, if my friend has blonde hair, if we find the specific chromosome, the gene for hair color will be found in the exact same place. It'll just be one codes for black hair, one codes for blonde hair. So the genome is ultimately the collection of all of your genes, all of your genetic information. And it's basically the base pairs written out. So it's got all of your bases, the sequence of all of the bases ultimately in all of your DNA spelled out. So that's your genome. So you can see it's a very, very, very big thing. We've got 134 million base pairs, but it's ultimately just a sequence of what's going on. And you can kind of think of, like, I feel like teachers always use this analogy of like recipe books and, you know, instructions, all that sort of thing. So if your genes are the recipes to create, you know, the food that is your hair color or whatever, the genome is like the big recipe book, or like the series of recipe books or something like that. So it's just a big collation that contains all of the genetic information ultimately. So the idea of the genome is that it was a product of this thing called the Human Genome Project. So it was this big thing, you know, about sequencing the human genome. So it was really helpful, because obviously, you know, you might think like, oh, what's the point of this? Or like, cool, you've got a lot of information. But it's really helpful for a bunch of things. So it was a very big project, but it obviously was very helpful in the kind of setting of disease, particularly genetic diseases, thinking about what genes code for what proteins, you know, what genes may even interact with each other. There is another, so the genome is your genes. Something else is your proteome. So these are your proteins, kind of the equivalent of a genome, but for proteins. And these ultimately, you know, the genome can kind of help in looking at the proteome and thinking about that and the importance of the proteome, you know, thinking about having this collection of what proteins you express, that's also really, really important. So having this kind of collection, this kind of sequence is a really important, it's not really a discovery, but an important project that happened. And you can see that this is just only like three of the benefits. So you can sequence genomes of other organisms, this idea of determining relatedness between species. This is something you'll look at in year 12. And then understanding the role of genes as well. So talking about the role of genes, for example, in certain diseases, in the progression of disease, things like that. But again, there's heaps more benefits that sort of came from that. So looking at chromosomes, so we've talked about, you know, you've got your little double helix. Your chromosome is basically the condensed sort of storage, storage device, I guess, of your DNA. So we have, your DNA is like, you know, you can kind of think of it as string almost. And it's just coiled and condensed very tightly, and then it makes up this bigger structure that is a chromosome. So I think that's something that might confuse people. Sometimes you might think that the double helix itself is in like the shape of a chromosome. It's not like that. The double helix is like a piece of string. So if you imagine a string and it's just coiled, and then that string is then, you know, wrapped around these proteins and then condensed into a really big molecule or big thing, that's your chromosome. So try not to think about it as like your DNA is in the shape of a chromosome, because that isn't the right way to think about it. So in eukaryotes versus prokaryotes, so eukaryotes are your more complex organisms and your prokaryotes are your simple, often unicellular things. So like your bacteria, for example, it's a prokaryote. So eukaryotes, like, you know, for example, animal cells, we've got multiple chromosomes and they are linear. So they're kind of like this shape or just a single line. So those are the chromosomes that we kind of think about for us. Whereas in a bacteria, they have one chromosome and it's in the shape of a circle. So that's kind of a difference to remember as well. So in terms of your chromosomes, I was talking about how DNA is like string wrapped around a protein. So these proteins are called histones. They're like little balls, I guess. I like to think of it as like if you have a tennis ball, which is your histone, and then you've got, you know, string or yarn or whatever, and you're just wrapping it around. That's how I kind of like to think of it. So then you basically chuck heaps of histones together, and then they will, you know, condense, and they're super, super duper squashed. And then you basically call it chromatin. So some of the terminology is a little bit hard to comprehend, but it's just important to understand how DNA is really condensed, and you can imagine how much DNA there is in a cell. So you've got your little histones, they're kind of chucked together, they're coiled and condensed even further to create this chromatin. This chromatin is then again folded, and basically you've just got more folding, more condensing, and then that gives you your chromosome. So I think we've got a little picture, coming up here. Okay, this should make a lot more sense. I feel like I've been talking and it might be hard to comprehend it, but you can see so here you've got your base pairing. This is, you know, your nucleotide. This is the smallest level we're thinking of here. You've got your double-stranded helix, and you can see that this is like a little string and this curls around a histone. So you can see you've got eight histones, you know, think of eight tennis balls sort of coming together. And then you've got around each of them, you've got this string kind of wrapped around, and then these create their own little balls. So these are your like little nucleosomes, and then those curl around even further. And then you can see that those squish around even more to form a chromosome. So hopefully this picture puts into context sort of how much DNA you've got going on, all of that genetic information, and how chromosomes are very advantageous because they basically pack all of that into a really nice tight spot where it just sits in the nucleus. When you're thinking about a prokaryote, we talked about how it's a single circular chromosome, so they don't, you know, have histones or anything like that. And that is fine because it can just be chucked in the middle of the cell because they're not very complex. There's not that much to them. Whereas if we were to do that, just to chuck all our DNA, kind of, you know, shove it together and put it in the cell, there would just be way too much and it would take up all the space and it would be horrible. So it's this idea that it's just extremely tightly condensed and then put into the nucleus. And so you can just kind of tuck away that genetic information. Okay, so our gene loci, again, we kind of talked about alleles. So loci is basically just a way of describing where a gene is found on a chromosome. So you will use, you know, it might be on the P arm or the Q arm, this idea if it's close to the centromere, stuff like that. But then they'll have specific numbers and that will tell you exactly where on the chromosome this specific gene can be found. So locus is a word you might see. It's a gene locus. It's just where the gene is found. And then two locus is a loci. Okay, so here is terminology you definitely have to know. So this is what your chromosome will usually look like. I know that we're all kind of used to seeing it in this picture, but it looks like this. And then when you replicate DNA to get ready for mitosis or for division, that's when you get this sort of typical X picture. So here we have homologous chromosomes. So homologous chromosomes are basically, they're the same chromosome. They've got the same genetic information, but they've come from separate parents ultimately. So that's why we have, you know, when we think of chromosomes, humans have 46 chromosomes, but 23 pairs, because you get 23 from one parent, 23 from the other parent. And then you get 46, but you can see how you've got chromosome 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way to 23. And so you've kind of got like two copies of one, two copies of two, but then they'll obviously be slightly different because they're from different people. So hopefully that makes sense in terms of homologous chromosomes, why we call them homologous, because they're the same but different. Same but different is kind of what we're looking at. Centromere is the center of the chromosome. And sister chromatids is when you duplicate or replicate your chromosome. And then you create this little X shape, sister chromatids. It's just the two ends. And they'll always be joined by the centromere. Okay, so you have different types of chromosomes. You've got your sex chromosomes and your autosomes. So again, when we were talking about humans, we've got 46 chromosomes. So we've got 23 pairs. We've got 22 pairs of autosomes. So that means 44 autosomes. And then two of them are sex chromosomes. And so these will determine if you are essentially female assigned at birth or male assigned at birth. And so you will get your two X chromosomes for female and then an X and a Y for male. So these are your sex chromosomes and that's what determines one's sex at birth. And then autosomes are just kind of all the other chromosomes that aren't sex chromosomes really. Yeah, so hopefully that makes sense. This is something to be aware of. I feel like some schools may emphasize it more than others. It's not really a major thing, but I do remember kind of reading about it in textbooks and stuff like that. But it's just how some chromosomes have their centromeres in different spots. So usually we're used to seeing chromosomes, you know, depicted in the middle. So this idea of metacentric, so there's equal space between, you know, between the centromere and the end of the short arm, and the end of the long arm. And then the centromere might be closer to the top or kind of like halfway to the top. And there's just different ways of describing that. It's not a super important thing, but again, it may come up in your SAC or assessment. It may not. But yeah, it's just something to be aware of, that you can have the centromere depicted at different spots. And when we look at a karyotype, you can see the chromosomes. You can see that they look a bit shorter. Or like, you know, one arm is obviously shorter than the other, or one arm is a little bit more equal. Okay, so your chromosome number differs based on your species. So we've got 46 in us, but other organisms will have a different number. So for example, a fly has 8 chromosomes. And again, you can think about how complex organisms are. Sometimes, you know, if you're more complex, you might have more chromosomes. So hopefully that makes sense. In terms of ploidy, so you hear the terms haploid and diploid. We'll talk about polyploidy a little bit later. But haploid basically means half of your normal number of chromosomes. So you've got one set of chromosomes. So like one of each of the 23 pairs, and then diploid, so di, kind of meaning two. You've just got that kind of full set. So two sets of chromosomes. So for, and we use N and 2N because again, in different organisms, you have different numbers. So in humans, 2N equals 46, N equals 23. Whereas in the fruit fly, 2N equals 8, N equals 4. So that's why you see N and 2N, because it differs between species. But in humans, you can just think about haploid being 23, diploid being 46. So karyotype is basically when we are able to visualize the chromosomes found in a certain organism. So we can have a look here, two human karyotypes, which is from a male and which is from a female. So remember, we talked about your autosome. So that's pairs 1 through 22. And then your sex chromosomes are usually written down there or shown down there at the bottom. So you can see the karyotype on the left has got two X chromosomes. The karyotype on the right has one X and one Y. So the one on the left would be female. The one on the right would be male. Hopefully that's making sense. And you can see they're ordered, as it says here, based on length or, you know, size and the centromere position. So you can see that number one, you know, two, three, they're quite long. And then as we get to the ones at the end, they're all a little bit shorter. And you can see kind of the centromere being up here or up here. But yeah, this is what your typical kind of karyotype will look like. It's important, we'll get to chromosomal abnormalities a little bit later, but understanding what a, you know, normal karyotype will look like. So then you can basically spot out if there's polyploidy, for example, or if there's a missing chromosome or an extra chromosome, for example. Okay, so hopefully this makes it a little bit clearer as to what they look like, but you can just order them and then they will be stained. So you can see here, again, the stain is a little bit hard to see in here, but they have banding, and this banding will kind of signify different gene loci and will tell you where certain genes are. So that is, again, really helpful from a karyotype. So they are useful in also noting abnormalities within the chromosome itself, such as banding patterns, or abnormalities in the number of chromosomes. So yeah, karyotypes may be done at birth if a chromosomal abnormality is suspected, for example. Okay, so why might karyotypes be carried out when the cell is in metaphase? So I know that we're getting to mitosis a little bit later, but if you recall, we talked about how chromosomes will look like that little X, or they'll look pretty big when they've been duplicated. So the idea is that when you are not preparing for mitosis, so ultimately when the chromosomes aren't being replicated, they're just kind of hanging around like loose in the nucleus. Well, not loose, but they're a bit, you know, thinner. They're not as condensed. Whereas when you're getting ready for mitosis, you're obviously replicating this DNA, and it's becoming a lot more condensed. And that's when they're most easy to visualize. That's when you can see them. So when we get to mitosis, you can see mitosis through a microscope, and you can see the actual chromosomes visibly through a microscope during mitosis. But when a cell is not dividing, you can't really make out chromosomes because of that idea that they're not condensed. So that's the idea there. Okay, so an example of a structure found in DNA, select the option that best represents the figure. So the idea that we're looking at here is we're looking at our histones forming our nucleosome. So we have our histone here. Remember that we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we've got 8 little histones that are coming together. And then once they have the DNA round, or spun around them, it's titled a nucleosome. Okay, so we're looking here at heterozygous and homozygous. Again, very important terms to understand. This is when we're getting into this, the discussion on alleles. So heterozygous basically means that you have got two different alleles, and homozygous means you've got two of the same. So this can be homozygous dominant, it can be homozygous recessive, but homozygous just means you've got two of the same pair of alleles. And so we can see this here. So this is two dominant alleles, two recessive alleles, And then if you've got one of each, then that would be heterozygous. So that's kind of what we're talking about there. Homozygous recessive, if you've got two recessive alleles. Homozygous dominant, if you've got two dominant alleles. If you are heterozygous, so you've got one dominant and one recessive allele, that means that you will show the dominant trait because, you know, dominant versus recessive. If you've got one dominant, it's going to overpower, I guess, the other allele. So in terms of notation, your dominant allele is marked with a capital letter and your recessive allele is marked with a lowercase, but they'll be the same letter. This would be your heterozygous, this would be your homozygous dominant and your homozygous recessive. So that's what you can kind of see there. So you would have, capital H represents the dominant allele, which is brown eyes. The lowercase h is blue eyes. So you would have brown eyes because your dominant homozygous, dominant. And this would be homozygous recessive. And as this one is heterozygous, it would be brown eyes as well, because again, you always show the dominant trait. So that's kind of when things are clear cut. You either have blue eyes or you've got brown eyes. With codominance, this is when basically you've got more than one dominant allele. And codominance, as the name suggests, is when they're both expressed. So a good example of this is your blood type. So you've got your ABO, you know, blood system. So if you are an AB blood type, you obviously express both. So you've got the A allele, the B allele, or no allele or no antigen. And that's ultimately what O is, as you can see here. But if you have A and B, as we can see with these two green ones, you don't have blood type A or you don't have blood type B, you've got blood type AB because they're codominant. So one isn't more, you know, powerful than the other. You express both of them. So hence the term codominance. If we think about a different side of this, it's incomplete dominance. So rather than both being expressed fully, so if you've got, you know, the A allele and the B allele, you would express the A antigen and the B antigen. With incomplete dominance, it's you've got both dominant alleles, so you express a mix of both. So as you can see here, we've got the pink flower and the white flower, and they're both dominant. So rather than expressing, you know, pink leaves and white leaves, which would be codominance because you're expressing both of the traits fully, incomplete dominance is when you've got a little bit of this mix. So you've got kind of a pale pink color that represents kind of this mix of, you know, hot pink and white ultimately. So that's that idea of incomplete dominance. So hopefully the distinction between codominance and incomplete dominance makes sense. So the difference between a genotype and a phenotype. Genotype is the actual allele that one's been given. So, you know, you're heterozygous or homozygous dominant, homozygous recessive, and your phenotype is what is expressed. So your genotype, you could be heterozygous. A different genotype would be homozygous dominant, but both a heterozygous person and a homozygous dominant person would express the same allele. So if you had, obviously there's no person here who's homozygous dominant, but if you had two, you know, capital B alleles, so two brown eye alleles, you would express brown eyes. And if you're heterozygous, you would express brown eyes as well. So the phenotype is the same, but the genotype is different. So hopefully that makes sense. Genotype, just think of the actual genes, the actual alleles. Phenotype, you don't care what's going on genetically. It's just what you see on the outside, basically. So your phenotype can be influenced obviously by your genes, but also by environmental factors, epigenetic factors as well. So for example, you've got someone with, blue eyes, but maybe they put in contacts. You've got someone with blonde hair, or maybe they dye it a different color. This idea that your phenotype, so the characteristic that is expressed kind of outwardly, that can obviously be influenced by the environment. And epigenetic factors as well. So epigenetic factors are basically how your genes can be altered as you live, almost. So for example, things like smoking or other things like that, you know, these might be environmental factors. They can influence genes, and then this can be passed down throughout an individual, for example. So we think about these things. I don't want to, you know, get into too much detail, but you can have the, ultimately the histone. It's kind of about which genes can be read more easily and which can't. This is when we think about epigenetics. It's kind of controlling or changing the expression of these genes. If you've got a histone, you can basically, okay, it's a bit more complex and I'll explain it, but the kind of analogy you can kind of think about it as is you are winding the DNA around the histone really, really tightly. So then it's kind of hard to like open the gene and read it and express it. So that gene doesn't get expressed that much. Whereas the other influence of epigenetics can be you're sort of loosening the tightness with which that DNA is wrapped around the histone. So then it's easier to read and that gene is expressed more. So that's the sort of idea there. Okay, so monohybrid crosses. So this is when your individual alleles become really important. You might, you know as Punnett squares, things like that. So it's when you are basically seeing what the offspring, what the outcome might be of two individuals with, you know, different alleles. So here we've got a homozygous dominant and a heterozygous person, or organisms, and where you're ultimately using this square, this monohybrid cross, to see what the chances are of their offspring having certain alleles. So you can see you'd get a homozygous dominant, you could get heterozygous, and you could, yeah, get heterozygous as well. So I might just flick back. You can see with this one, it's obviously different. So you've got a 50% chance of the offspring being heterozygous, 50% of it being homozygous recessive. The other one here is sort of 50% the other way, 50% homozygous dominant, 50% heterozygous. And so it just gives you kind of an idea about what the offspring would express. And you can see here that there is no chance that any of their offspring would have the recessive phenotype or the recessive, you know, express the recessive allele. So for example, if we're thinking about eye color here, if your capital H is brown eyes and your lowercase h is blue eyes, if you have a homozygous dominant person with a homozygous recessive person, sorry, heterozygous person, there's no way that their offspring will have blue eyes because there's no option here where you've got homozygous recessive. It's the same thing if homozygous dominant was to pair with homozygous recessive, because the thing is, if you've got someone that is homozygous dominant, the only allele they can give is the dominant one. And if the only allele they can give is the dominant one, there's no way that their children could have the recessive allele, if that makes sense. So this, you know, say this is an individual, they could have like 100 children, and unless it's a mutation, they won't be having someone with blue eyes because they don't have that allele. And so obviously, you know, the offspring may get the recessive allele from the other parent, but you need two copies of that recessive allele to express the recessive phenotype. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. You can see, yeah, for all four of these, they would express the same phenotype. So we've talked about the sex chromosomes here. Again, this is what you're looking at on your karyotype. So you've got an X and a Y for males and two X chromosomes for females. So in terms of how that plays into genetics, with the X chromosome, it's obviously a lot longer than the Y chromosome. So your what we call X-linked inheritance is more common because you basically inherit more genes from that X chromosome. So if you've got a certain trait that's X-linked, it's more likely that that will come from the X chromosome. Hopefully that, does that make sense? Yeah. You're more likely to have something that's X-linked than Y-linked just because there's a lot more space for genes, ultimately, is what I'm trying to say. Hopefully that makes sense. So we can see here, the idea is that with your X-linked trait, so let's say we've got a genetic disease that is found on a gene on the X chromosome. If you are a male, you only need one copy of that allele and you will express it. Whereas if you're a female, you'll need two. So hopefully that makes sense. Because if you think about, I think colorblindness is a common one they use. It is X-linked. that right? I think that's right. Yeah. It's X-linked. The idea is that if you have this little gene for color blindness on the X chromosome, as a mother, if you have seven sons, they will all be colorblind, if that makes sense, because you only have X chromosomes that are colorblind. And so because the son, oh my gosh, hopefully I'm explaining this, but because the son gets one X chromosome and the mother is giving X chromosomes that have colorblindness, the colorblindness gene, they're only getting one copy of that X chromosome. So hopefully that makes sense. Whereas if you are female, you'll get an X chromosome from one parent, X chromosome from the other. So if your mother is colorblind, you may get that colorblind gene. But then if your father isn't, you won't be colorblind because you don't have two copies of that. Hopefully that makes sense. I'm so sorry if that was the worst explanation ever. But it's just that idea that females almost have like a little backup because they've got two X chromosomes. Whereas if you have a genetic disease on an X chromosome and you're a male, you're going to be expressing that. Hopefully that makes sense. Okay, moving on. But yeah, a Punnett square is basically exactly the same. You just denote the little, so let's say this is like color blindness. You just denote the little thing on your X chromosome. So you can see here, this would be the colorblind one if it's the recessive allele. Okay. But then as you can see here, if this is for colorblindness, we've got one that is not for colorblindness. So you won't be expressing that. Okay. Hopefully that makes sense. So looking at pedigree charts, we're not going too into detail with this, but you can look and observe traits or, you know, diseases that have been passed down and figure out if they're autosomal dominant, if they're recessive, if they're X-linked, if they're Y-linked. So we can see here, the pattern here is autosomal recessive. So we are looking at, we can see here, this is a good pair to look at. If you've got two parents who are autosomal recessive, all of their children will have the same thing. So if you've got, let's say blue eyes, you know, blue eyes is recessive, your brown eyes are dominant. If you've got a couple with blue eyes and they're both homozygous recessive, which they would be, all their children will have blue eyes. All their children will express that trait. Again, it may not be that simple. You know, there may be other genes controlling things. But that's the idea there, that if you have two parents who are homozygous recessive, the only allele you have are those two, or, you know, those recessive ones. So that's what your children are going to express. Whereas you can see here, maybe, you know, for example, not too sure, but maybe in this case, this person may be homozygous dominant. So that's why all the children, or I should say none of the children show the disease or the allele. And I should mention the way to figure out if they're showing it or not is if you have a colored in box. But as you can see here, we've got heterozygous or homozygous dominant. The idea is that they're not expressing the recessive allele, but one of their children is homozygous recessive, which means someone in here, there has to be an allele somewhere in there. Both of these people are not homozygous dominant. They must be heterozygous. Because remember from our Punnett square, if one of these people were homozygous dominant, it wouldn't be possible to have a child with a recessive genotype, homozygous recessive genotype. Okay, so